Good evening, good afternoon, good morning to wherever you're watching my podcast from here in the Philippines and from all over the world. Welcome to my podcast, the RJ Ledesma Podcast. I'm so glad to finally be back here on the podcast. Now here on the podcast, I like to interview the country's trailblazing and pioneering business personalities and entrepreneurs to learn more about how they think about doing business, what are their success secrets, and can we replicate those success secrets? At the same time, are they willing to share those success secrets with us? How have these business personalities innovated, pivoted, evolved their businesses during the pandemic? But more importantly, what business opportunities do they see emerging in the new normal? And will they share these business opportunities together with us? Now, is there a business personality or entrepreneur that you would like me to interview here in the program? Please let me know. I would love to learn from them. All you have to do is just drop me a message. I would also like to learn from them as well. We're also live right now on YouTube and on Kumu. Now, tonight is going to be a very interesting show. And I really want to bring this guest on the show because recently I had a chance to host Ignite 2023. And in Ignite 2023, they had the Startup World Cup regional competition for the Philippines, where 9 really fantastic startups pitched their startup. And out of the 9, they're all very, very good. The winner was SolX Technologies. So SolX Technologies has won the opportunity to represent the Philippines at the 2023 Startup World Cup Grand Finale in Silicon Valley in the States, and a chance to win a $1 million, that's right, $1 million grand prize. Of course, they also won some money as well from the startup competition here in the Philippines. We'll find out more about that one from the founder, who will be speaking with us in just a few minutes. At the same time, if you're wondering what SolX does, briefly what SolX does, just high level, is that SolX is a platform that helps local companies in identifying ideal power contracts and retail electricity suppliers, leading to cost-effective decisions on their energy consumption. I know that's a lot to take in, and I'm so glad that I have the founder over here to explain the concept and make it more understandable to the layman. But just to let you know that this company has been very effective. It's already saved their big ticket clients close to 400 million pesos in energy costs to their systems as of date. But more importantly, their technology is 100% Filipino-made, and their team is all based here and they all hail from the Philippines. So tonight, it's my pleasure to welcome the winner of the regional startup competition here in the Philippines. Let's welcome Sergius Santos, the CEO of SolX. Serge, welcome to the show.
Hi, RJ. Good evening. And good evening, everyone. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. And
Serge, I wanted to invite you for quite some time because you did such a fantastic job in the regional World Cup pitch here that was held in Fairmont. Now, before everything else, congratulations. What prize did you win from the regional competition?
It's really the main prize is more on the chance to pitch in the Startup World Cup finals in Silicon Valley. So it's actually in itself is very big, regardless of the cash, particularly because Pegasus Tech Ventures, who will actually be hosting the Startup World Cup or who have been hosting the Startup World Cup, is one of the investors of SpaceX, Twitter's. Wow. And they handle one of the biggest funds in Silicon Valley, around close to $3 billion. So just being able to have that affiliation, hopefully when we pitch in San Francisco, we can develop deeper connections with them or other big players in the industry. And also the special awards, of course, like the E27, and then the other awards have their own corresponding you know, for E27, we will have the subscription for that. And then I think it's an all-expense trip to Silicon Valley for Kate, courtesy of Ignite team. Yeah.
Fantastic. Were there any monetary prizes as well? Did you get any financial?
No. Yeah. Okay. I think the financial will be on the grand finals, if ever.
Yeah. Oh, for the grand finals. But really fantastic job. Now, like I said, I had a chance to host it. I got to see all of you over there. And it was incredible because I have to say, you're up against some really tough competition, right?
Yeah, I agree, yeah. And the thing about the Philippine Leg Finals, it's not limited to Philippine startups. It's actually just hosted in different countries, and any startups from anywhere around the world can participate. And one of the companies, I think, was from a few were from US hailed companies. So it was very tough. But at the same time, I'm glad to be at least to be very fortunate to represent the Philippines, since it's a Philippine leg finals that we took home the prize in our home country. Yeah.
And before everything else, can I just ask you, since you're here, it was like you were the first among equals, because I think they were all good. But were there other companies there, that other startups which impressed you as well when they while they were? Can you share?
For example, the Wika, I think the Wika gave a very heartfelt presentation. They're supposedly doing content management system for accessibility for deaf people, because that's something that is taken for granted. Although it's a very niche market, it allows, you know, certain segment of the, at least the population, to be really heard. So they're doing a lot of content management and they're doing VR. So in terms of the actual fundamental impact, it's really up there, maybe better than us. I guess it's really more on the scalability. That's where the judges scored. And then there's also an AI company there, Snarly, which it's like wrapping the GPT technology for their own use. So yeah, it's a basically generative AI technology. But all the rest are equally fantastic.
Yeah, that's why I was so impressed that you guys, I mean, not to say that you didn't deserve to, but I mean, just to show you the caliber of the competition you're up against. It's not that some, it's something that you all admire at the same time when you're here. Yeah. And seeing yours, you go, wow. Then you see the next one, you go, wow. So it was really just a matter of, I guess, what the criteria was for what they wanted to help grow the company.
I agree.
And having seen that you guys won, there are also people who like listening to the program to pick up some tips, especially some startup companies who are doing pitching. Now, over the years, and especially for this particular cup, and you guys won, is there anything also that you want to share when people want to pitch their concepts to VCs, to venture capitalists, to big investors, or even during competition? What do you think you were able to do or establish a bit differently, or that you've been practicing a lot that has worked for you, especially during the pitches, that you can share with the other potential startups who are also listening and hoping to make that pitch?
Yeah, actually, this is like our third pitch. And I think one of the things that we at least personally, I took note of is very important to know your audience. There are a lot of pitching styles that you can do. There can be the heartfelt style. There can be a very narrative story. It can also be very informative. So know your audience. So I'm not sure if what I did was correct, but I researched the judges, and they're basically VCs and institutional VCs from here and abroad. So one of the things they're really looking at is a combination of impact, scalability, and team. So it's very important to be able to be as informative as possible within those 5 minutes, and to be able to have some ready answers whenever they have some follow-up. So what I did practice was really very an informative setting, compressing it into 5 minutes, especially difficult for us because later you'd know that it's a very contextualized startup. So it's not something that you can do a pitch for like 1 minute or 2 minutes and people would instantly understand. So it takes some getting to know, especially if you're outside the industry. So yeah, number one is to know your audience. And second is, I think, although some people would not prefer this, I think it's very important to memorize your pitch. Memorize in a sense that you don't know it word per word, but you actually know the full outline of your pitch so that you can compress it into the actual time limit. Because a lot of companies, they tend to think that, oh, I can do this in 3 minutes. I can go over the time. It doesn't matter. But when you're there and you actually did not practice enough, and then it's already almost the time, and then you have a lot of catching up to do, you'll tend to really compress everything in a few seconds with no value at all. So very important to practice, memorize. But at the end of the day, don't memorize it word per word, but have a very clear, detailed outline of where you are, how many minutes you're going to put on and this segment and this segment. So very technical, I would say, in terms of the actual criteria. And then the third will be having that combination of focusing on what I said earlier. Number one, impact, how big your impact is as a company. because there are a lot of companies that can be benchmarked, but what about the actual potential impact of the company? I really believe that our company has the biggest potential impact out of all the startups that have pitched, because we're particularly dealing with energy prices in the Philippines. And second is, how do you build that scalability? How do you show the audience that you have that scalability in terms of the actual tech? Because there's a lot of manual processes involved in certain startups as well, especially when they're starting. So how do you show that narrative that everything can be scaled because of your tech? And third is, of course, your team. So the team angle that we put in is really more focusing on the Filipinos, because basically Filipinos for the Philippines, because there's a lot of startups in the Philippines that have been successful, but they're actually hailing from different countries abroad. They're actually abroad, and they have a lot of experiences applying best practices. But at the end of the day, who knows better about our context but us? So having that, at least having this kind of advantage, it's very important for us to tell that story. Having one of the few who are actually 100% Filipinos, and everything is developed in house, no outsourced technology whatsoever. Yeah.
Well, and that says a lot about the group. And I like that, you know, it's really a context, like you said, it's a contextualized solution particularly here in the Philippines. And having said that, let's now get into what SolX is all about. Mm-hmm. Even when I read it earlier on and explained to people, it's still not going to sink in. Like you said, it takes you more than 2 minutes to explain it. But if you were to give, and you've given elevator pitches for SolX, so people can just get a feel of what an elevator pitch means. It's like a 30-second pitch that you have to give more or less to a big executive. What is that elevator pitch that you had for SolX?
No, just disclaimer, I'm not really good at elevator pitch, but I would try. Basically, SolX Technologies enables businesses to save on energy costs by enabling sustainability and energy efficiency through our digital demand supply matching platform, allowing you to connect best with the right fit energy supplier, and also to save further on energy costs by optimizing on how you use power. So I think
thanks. I mean, it kind of blows the mind, but I mean, if we were to pick up basic things, basically is that you've developed an app to help lower power costs for big companies, right? Mm-hmm. That's basically it, by being able to source correctly from whatever electricity supplier that he might need at that particular time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Agreed, yeah. So maybe maybe going back a little in terms of context, I think everyone, households especially, knows that they can only source power from Meralco if you're living in Metro Manila or in Laguna or the franchise area of Meralco, basically. That's your only provider. But actually what really happens is these distribution utilities cooperatives actually just buy power in bulk from the different power plants. So effectively, they buy power from power plant A, B, C, they consolidate it, and they sell it to the customers at a fixed rate. So that was basically the status quo of the market for years. Recently, they deregulated the energy market, effectively allowing you to purchase directly from energy suppliers. However, this regulation is limited to B2B customers. Basically, if you're consuming around 100,000 pesos per month in terms of your energy billing, then you can avail of this regulation. That's why a lot of household level are not really aware of this regulation, because it's being benchmarked in the B2B sector currently. So basically what we do as a company, imagine you have 47 different options. How do you know that switching from one provider to another provider can actually lead to better costs? How do you know that switching from Meralco to another provider will not actually affect you negatively? So this is where we come in. So effectively, a power plant, it produces energy at a certain time. For example, if it's a solar power plant and it's like 8 to 5, right? Or during the solar hours. And energy, once you actually produce it, someone has to offtake it, unless you have a battery storage. But battery storage facilities in the Philippines are not scaled, actually even abroad. So effectively, if you have an 8 to 5, you actually must offtake it, or must basically put that power to a user who consumes energy from 8 to 5, exactly at that level of capacity. And also,
so for people who are not so aware of the power sector, solar power, you have to consume the solar power when it's generated.
Correct. And what we do is, if we have different types of power plants in the Philippines, we try to connect the fittest energy supplier for you and the fittest energy consumer for you. If a consumer consumes energy from 8 to 5, it's better to connect them to a supplier that produces 8 to 5. If you have, for example, a supplier that produces 24/7, but you're a school, you don't have leverage in actually changing your operations, we can aggregate you to another customers that actually have another consumption that is basically the non-school hours, so that effectively it's a 24-hour cycle. So we really try to close the loop in terms of demand-supply matching, because one of the reasons why cost of power in the Philippines is high is because of that supply and demand mismatch, primarily driven by lack of data access and a lack of digitalization in the energy sector, besides a lack of transparency. Yeah.
Got it. So basically, the biggest pain point here is that, well, in terms of this power consumption, rather, is that we just don't know how much power is being, we're just taking it lock, stock, and barrel.
Correct.
But technically, if you parse it up, you can get best bang for your buck, your best value for money, if you get the right supplier producing at the right time for your particular business.
Correct. And one of the things that we're also, that's correct, RJ, one of the other layer that we're doing is, for the longest time, we see the customers as a problem. It's basically a variable that doesn't change, because customers, they don't know how to change their operations. So for example, even if you change how you consume energy when you turn off your air conditions, nothing's gonna happen with your energy bill. But because of the democratizing access to energy in terms of understanding and in terms of data, customers now, at least those with us, are now part of the solutions. So even them, they can actually augment their operations, put it in a particular hours just to save on power, just to have that kind of contracts that have certain incentives and penalties. So this, in a way, allows the energy market to have both flows coming from the supply, helping the demand close the loop, and the demand actually helping the supply. So effectively, hopefully merging them together to create a really balanced demand and supply in the Philippines. Yeah.
So what that just means is that the more companies that subscribe to SolX Technologies, the better it will be for both the power companies and for the businesses, because there's more data that's there. You'll be able to aggregate or consolidate power correctly. Yeah. Is that a correct understanding?
Yeah, exactly, RJ. That's our goal, really, to have volume, because if you don't have volume, it's harder to balance, really. And if you don't have data accessibility, there's not enough flexibility in order to balance supply and demand. But yeah, that's correct. That's the big goal of the company, to generate value from both supply chain and eventually to ramp up our volume to create or at least to exponentially grow the value that we provide. Yeah.
Okay. Now, I like how we actually tried to laymanize the concept a bit more, try to make it simpler. Is there a way to even make it more explainable or understandable to your Pinoy out there?
Yeah. At least the goal of the company, eventually, if it goes down to the household level, the Filipinos don't really have to actually think about how to properly balance their consumption. We handle the headache of the energy so that you can focus on your business and your personal matters and your work. So eventually, there can be an app that allows you to be connected to different customers so that you can be connected to a right supplier or to a multiple supplier options. But that's our goal. But in terms of your question of maybe laymanizing it further, I would say we have a hardware and a software. The hardware allows us to collect data granularly every 30 seconds. And that allows us to actually properly analyze the different consumption patterns of different customers so that we can connect them to the right supplier. So effectively, as a supplier, you have your own power plants, and a power plant have their own production schedule when they produce energy, and they also have their own location where they are located. In order to save power, two of the most basic value proposition would be get a power closest to your location so that you don't have to pay online rental fees or the distance between the power plants to your actual facility. And second is the matching that I mentioned earlier. If you have a supplier that supplies energy 24/7, it's best to connect this to a customer that consumes power 24/7 or to a group of customers that consumes power 24/7. So effectively affecting both location and consumption metric. Yeah. Sorry, RJ.
I get that. But so eventually, just to make it even maybe more understandable, the ultimate objective of this app, which is right now B2B, business to business, is that if it goes business to consumer, it's all about the app. Just automatically, your power will just switch to the best power source that is lowest in cost for you, right?
Correct, yeah.
That's going to happen.
Exactly, yeah. And even giving you insights on how you can further save on costs by maybe changing some of your operations and identifying certain high deviations or high discrepancies in your consumption patterns. So the goal is of the app is not for the user to understand it per se, but to really focus on action points where they can save on the bottom line. Yeah.
Got that. Now, one of the things which I didn't get to say earlier on because I was too excited to ask you about the competition was that your app is very practical. It's something not practical, but rather it's something that is what even the government perceives as revolutionary, that you even receive money from a government-owned and controlled corporation after the competition. Tell me a bit more about that one.
Yeah, that's actually really great news for us and the startup community. So the National Development Company, actually, they have a fund called the Startup Venture Fund. I'm sure most of the startup entrepreneurs who might be watching knows about this. It's an SVF fund. Actually, under the Startup Innovation Act, the government will put or allocate money for startups, basically roughly around 500 million or to 1 billion pesos. But that was since 2019, I believe. But there was no deployment of fund except the deployment with us. So this is the first time in 4 years since the fund was created. So this will actually create, hopefully, a ripple effect for other startups to have more to be granted opportunities to actually, you know, get funding from the government and to the government to actually funnel that money to infuse economic economic infusion through these startups because they have the fund anyway. So one of the key criteria there, that's why we are able to get it, is so for other interested startups, maybe, is before they give a fund, you have to have been funded or should be funded by an accredited partner. So they have a few accredited investor companies in the Philippines. So effectively, it's a co-investment. So they have the Foxmont Capital, which is our first investor. They have Idea Space. They have Core Capital or the Gobi Ventures. And the fourth one was another Japanese company. So that's Real Tech Holdings. So Real Tech Holdings is basically, this is their first investment in the Philippines as well. So actually, they're a co-investment partner of NDC. So we are a product of pilot investment from both companies. So yeah, we're very happy and excited. Investment will allow us to have more credibility locally. And then the international investment from a Japanese corporation will allow us to have better footing whenever we decide to expand in different countries. Yeah.
Oh, bravo to you guys. Yeah, now, having got to that whole spiel, no? I think it's very important right now we get back again to the idea of, you know, how we help our entrepreneurs think of what pain point were you originally trying to solve when you created SolX. And I guess it's more informative for the people listening to us here right now to understand what is your background and how did you come across this problem? Because it's something that, you know, pain points are usually things that people see but aren't able to solve. Or it's always been there. So people just ignore it because they're just so used to the problem. So what was your background that led you to coming across this pain point?
Yeah, thank you, RJ. So by education, I'm a graduate of Electronics and Communications Engineering in Ateneo. And then I took my master's in Japan, systems engineering. And then I had a few study abroad in HKUST and in Taiwan as well. So, but basically, by profession, or at least by background, I'm really an engineer. And I also taught briefly statistics in UP Dilemat. However, how I encountered this problem was way back when I was in college, 2015. So as a matter of fact, energy is a very nuanced industry, esoteric, meaning it's very hard to understand even if you search thoroughly in the internet, very hard to know the regulations that you can benefit from. So luckily, there was a power camp. When I say power camp, it's like a recruitment camp focusing on power by one of the largest renewable energy company. Effectively, it's like a three-day extensive training and seminars and team building introducing the different regulations in the Philippines. So
you attended this one, the Power Camp. Can I ask what interested you? I mean, not everybody wants to go, I want to attend the Power Camp. What made you want to attend the Power Camp?
No, I'm a very I'm a scholar from through and through, from high school and all the way to my master's, so I didn't have to pay anything. So came from a lower class family, so every opportunity for me counts in college. So
I see.
But of course, I was interested in energy, but I wouldn't say I was passionate about it. So it's more like, oh, there's an opportunity where I can maybe get a job after. So that's really my motivation.
Employment. Employment is a key motivator to attend all the seminars out there. Yes, yeah. Yes. Oh, got it.
And it's the first of its kind in the Philippines. Because there are no courses available in the country that will teach you the opportunities in the energy sector deep dive. So that's a key motivator for me to join. And after that, I was able to immerse myself in the different nuances in the energy sector, different pain points. And the succeeding 2 years, I serve as the mentor for the other people who joined the Power Camp in the next few iterations. And then after graduation, actually, I had a job offer from that company. So, however, I decided to pursue my master's in Japan, in congruent with that is starting the company. Yeah.
So, wow, you instead of taking the job, you did another master's and you put up a company at the same time. That makes me curious because, you know, for people like you, scholars, the idea is that temporary, after you're done, you want to be able to start, you know, making, you know, earning money, but you chose to continue your scholarship for higher studies. Plus you put up your own company at the same time. That's pretty brave. And that's pretty, you know, if you think about it, it's not an easy decision to make. Help me better understand, why did you decide to go that route and also put up your own company even when you were doing your master's? Because that's not something, it's not such I would say it was not so rational, but it's not something that, you know, it's not an easy decision to make, right?
Agree, RJ. Actually, maybe just as on a side note, before I was very academic. I wanted to be number one in grades and also to have this conventional awards. But I was granted an opportunity to study in Hong Kong. It's my first time abroad. That's where I realized the value of actual, you know, just opening your horizon, actual networking, developing relationship, the soft skills, and actually looking at different key skills that you can develop along the way. So when I went back for my study abroad program, I focused on organizations in Ateneo, honing my leadership skills, project management, while at the same time being technically adept. So that kind of holistic balancing is what I realized is very important. So when there was an opportunity to study in Japan, I realized that it's another layer of growth that I can take advantage of, particularly because Japan is very big on technology. So I will be immersed with the different key sectors. That's one of the reasons why we have two Japanese investors as well. So having that Japanese tie for myself. And then as a matter of fact, I wouldn't put so much credit on myself because it was not a hard decision. Why? Because the scholarship in Japan offers a really high paying salary for my allowances. So at least I would save some while being able to completely immerse myself in that kind of setting where I would learn not just the Japanese culture, but being able to extend myself beyond the Philippines in terms of network, in terms of actually getting to know possible colleagues, basically team members in the future. And this startup company, I had a friend, an angel investor, that decided on trusting me. So it's not an easy decision for people who have to balance risk appetite, having to give back to family, and also creating your entrepreneurship journey. Because for me, after graduation, I wanted to start basically working so that I can earn money. And eventually, I wanted to start a company from the nuances and the things that I will be learning from a corporate job. But it just so happens, fortunately, that I was granted an opportunity to explore both, having that scholarship with a significant allowance and also following my entrepreneurship journey. But
so you were setting up the company while you were in Japan?
We set up the company before I went to Japan. So I actually asked my co-founders that I can quit my company if they want me to, or we can stick together and then I can help them build while balancing my master's in Japan. It really just took a toll on me in terms of time management, not having explored Japan to the fullest because I have to balance both. But I would say it's a worth it decision, yeah.
Got it. So tell me, what was the first iteration of the company? Because like I said, you saw the pain point. When did you discover that pain point after the power camp? And was the company put up solving that pain point which you uncovered?
Mm-hmm. So actually, SolX is like our second company, I would say. We started the first company, Xora Technologies, where maybe some viewers might be familiar. That's what we started after graduating in college and while taking my master's in Japan. The pain point there really is the lack of transparency in the energy market. Effectively, if you want to switch outside Meralco or outside your distribution utility, how do you know if this is the best option? So there's a lack of transparency. So we developed basically an auction platform, effectively like a marketplace, allowing customers to see what are the options in the market and to provide an enhanced competitive process so that suppliers can bid instantaneously a number of times. So basically that's it. That's the first company. And this company right now is really quite different in terms of all the services that we offered. But the reason for closing that is some founder issues that we encountered along the way. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So again, sometimes your first iteration is not your ultimate iteration for business. And that's one thing that we want to point out to people, that sometimes your first idea is not your best idea, but it leads you towards the best idea. In other words, you've got to set it up, you've got to run it, you've got to see the paper doing it and see how it has to go. So when you Xora was the first company you put up, and you were also in Japan at the same time. Mm-hmm. It was supposed to be a place to have competitive auctions for power. What you see were the learnings from that one? What were the pain points that you saw that didn't seem to work from the first version?
I think the thing that we really saw is conglomerate seeing that there are young entrepreneurs that's willing to not really go head on against them, but to really try to disrupt the industry. Because power is also an oligopoly, as much as it's a monopoly before the regulation. So there's only a few suppliers available in the market. And for young students to be able to just create or say that we're going to create a platform that will basically level the playing field for all suppliers is a big endeavor in itself. And it creates a signal in the market that this can happen. And some suppliers are actually very supportive towards it. So, of course, we have some mixed reactions and mixed signals. But what we learned or what we saw from that pain point is that even a brave undertaking such as this is possible. You just have to really try and get all the help that you can get. And one of the key learnings that we were able to really learn from this journey is you really cannot do this alone. So it takes a level of awareness and acceptance that you have to partner with key people. You have to accept that, basically ask for help. We can't do this without you guys. So, yeah.
So how did it go? Because I'm thinking right now, larger power companies might not be, they go, either you are their competition, and that's most primarily how they might have thought, instead of somebody they can collaborate with. Mm-hmm. And it's hard going head-to-head with them. How was that initially for you guys?
Mm-hmm. Technically, we don't go head-to-head against them, but enabling this kind of ecosystem will allow them to go head-on-head against each other, which some of them do not want. So that kind of, maybe threat is not the right word, but that kind of disruptive mechanism basically is, you know, very, is a big undertaking. So, sorry, what's the question, RJ, again?
Yeah. No, but how did you guys have to react? Because these are bigger players than you, and you're a smaller player, and they might think that you're disrupting us too much. What were the, I guess, what happened to you guys when that was happening? Because I'm just imagining they have a lot of resources. They can say, okay, we'll stop.
Yeah.
How did you guys manage through that?
Yeah. So of course, in the first few client attempts, the client themselves are the blockers because power is a major thing for them. It's effectively like 60% of their production costs. So if that's disrupted by these young students, what will happen to our actual margins to the entire line of business? So that kind of skepticism, even though we know what we're talking about, is very difficult to actually just hurdle through. And in terms of the suppliers, the biggest hurdle initially, of course, is they do not want to disclose their data to a platform such as ours because we're young and we don't have any clients yet. So what we did is we focus on people that actually trust us, the suppliers that believe in the kind of vision that we provide in the ecosystem. And in the client side, how we're able to hurdle through is by asking for help. The first thing I did when I came from my master's in Japan after the whole founder issues where I tried to fix everything because we have zero clients and almost zero money that time, is I went to all the people that I can think of. And then the first one was the Ateneo, and I asked them, can you give us help? We will actually close if we don't close any client at this point. So that kind of just showing that vulnerability and also that kind of courage in terms of approaching them help us. So we actually close our first client in that in Exora by Ateneo just basically vetting us, telling the client that they know us. Basically they can vet the tech and everything. And it's their name. Basically, we're banking from their name and reputation. And from that point forward, it's a matter of maintaining relationships and then closing more supplier accounts. Yeah.
Got that. And I hope you don't mind, because I had a chance to listen to your pitch, and you did say that you underwent some founders' problems. Mm-hmm. And these were not tech related. I would say human relations related. Can you share with us a bit more about that? Just as you know, how it can educate also people who are looking for founders. What did you learn from your founders' experience that you maybe would like to share that hopefully other startups might be able to learn from?
Yeah, maybe just high level. What happened is there was some financial issues in the company, so there were some financials that were not disclosed. Appropriated properly by one of the founders, and also there was some misrepresentations to clients and potential investors about our actual revenue, etc. So both financials and misrepresentation, which are actually really big. So what we learned from here, maybe for the viewers, is it's very important to create a system of check and balances that forces everyone to actually comply. It's okay to basically start a company with your friends, but no matter how long your relationship is money and finances are very sensitive. And also having that alignment in terms of how you represent your company is very important. So you have to have that system that forces trust, basically.
Mm-hmm. And then, so the other company, Exora, did it have to close down?
We actually closed it, yeah. So basically what happens is we fix everything when I came back. So we didn't want to close it just because there were some founder issues, just to start fresh. So what we did is to really come clean with different investors and different companies, saying that this is what happened and we're really trying to reinvent the company in making it a better, just making it better, cleaning the reputation, so that Exora will have a very clean reputation moving forward. And then when we actually decided that it's already clean, everything is managed, and that's where we decided to start a new company so that it's a clean slate. And also just to, not think about all those struggles from before. And also we expanded our services to cover a lot more plethora of value-added things. So we decided to create SolX. Also to accept more investments, so that when an investor comes in, there's no issues from the earlier founders, etc., that they will have to deal with. Because if you want really this to grow big, everything has to be clean from day zero all the way. But so, before even doing that, we decided to clean the reputation first of the initial company. Yeah.
And I think it's very key. I think the reputational integrity was very key for you to be able to. And I think they, like you said, that they saw the sincerity from that one. Mm-hmm. Being able to clean things up. Help me just understand, because we're talking about it from a high level, but then, you know, it does take a toll on you emotionally, spiritually, physically. Mm-hmm. Tell us a bit more about that one, and how did you, if you don't mind, how you got through that, because it's something also that people can learn from.
Oh, definitely. We will not get through that without the support system. So the founders that I have with SolX Technologies are one of the main reasons why I'm able to get through it, because it's a shared struggle, maybe a shared trauma after all, but that is key. And besides that, knowing how to struggle, it's also just seeing where you're going. So having that clear vision of where you're headed is very important, because at least you know that even if it's slowly moving, it's moving. So having that little milestones along with the support system is very important. And of course, the third key criteria here, or at least the third factor that allows us to move forward from the struggles, is just being able to share this struggle with fellow founders. Because matter of fact, even though ours is a very unique stories, other founders have very similar stories, maybe different in nature, but the level of emotional emotional bandwidth that they have to really take on is very high. And being able to see them from this to this, basically hurdling through it, is, you know, a testament that we can also get through it. So support system, having clear milestones, and seeing basically mentors and people who have undergone this similar experiences that have actually been able to hurdle through that is very important. Yeah. And of course, praying is very important. Yeah.
Yeah, you'll be down on your knees. Any entrepreneur is always down on his knees praying, oh God, please help me out. I'm gonna pay salaries tomorrow. Where's the money coming from?
Oh yeah, that's very, very difficult. Yeah.
And then I just want to know, because you know, there came a point, okay, that you started climbing out again of the sort of hole that you were in, and you were fixing things up. And as you start moving up, I just want to know, what was that point finally when SolX, where you felt that, oh my gosh, SolX is going to, you know, be something, or it's going to make it, or it's coming out of this hole, or it's established something. What is that feeling for you, parang even an emotional or a milestone in terms of an achievement that you had, that you felt, you said, okay, your motivation changed, you know, you felt, oh, we're going to make it. What was that point for you, SolX?
Mm-hmm. I think when we started SolX, we received initial investments, and we were able to close a lot of clients in a year. So maybe totaling to around 200 megawatt or around 50 plus clients. So, and being able to be invested by a Japanese company and Foxmoon Capital is very important for us. And after that, we won the pitch competition and the government invested in us. And we have deeper relationships with the regulators now, with the suppliers. So that moment where we think that this is going to happen, actually, even before starting SolX, we decided that we're going to start a new corporation and we're going to make it big. We're going to put all our efforts here. But when it actually happened, it's such a big relief, because we might not be the biggest startup company in the Philippines in terms of actual traction, actual investment round. But we really think that in terms of that struggle from negative to where we are, we're at par with the people that have started. And we raised when the climate of funding was really bad, so especially right now in 2022 to 2023. It was really bad. It was really hard to raise. One of the key criteria there is either a path to profitability, but actually it's really profitability. So that was a really hard climate for us, because prior to that, you can look at volume, you can look at actual criteria in tech, and you can raise big. So being able to raise at this climate and being able to close clients allows us to, you know, number one, be prepared not to, you know, burn our funding outright. And also we've learned from past experiences how to conservatively manage finance and to build a company from that. So that's very important for us. We're taking in money when we have that experience of actually learning how to properly put resources. Because when we had almost none, we were able to actually get to a profitability standpoint. What about that we have something right now? So that kind of balance, or at least this kind of timing when the investment came in, is actually a blessing for us because investment is not something to just, you know, celebrate success in. It's actually an accountability and a liability. It's a responsibility for us. So yeah.
Got that. Matthew Kua over here in the comment section gives you a big heart over here. So just let you know, Matt Kua, thanks so much. Thanks so much for listening in as well. Really appreciate it. It's such a great story that you have here right now. Can you just help us better appreciate, you've been saying the goal of what you guys are doing. Right now, what's stated, at least in the articles I've read, you've helped companies save at least $400 million,
I think. Power
costs. What are you guys seeing over the next 2 to 3 years, or even up to the 5 years for SolX?
Yeah, the main goal of SolX is really to trickle this kind of impact to the residential level. So the government actually wants to trickle this regulation all the way to the household level, similar to Singapore and Japan. But one of their blockers is the market actually ready for that? So digital infusion is a key factor. So we wanted to be one of the key primary movers in that market to show the regulators that the market is ready because of technologies such as ours or even other technologies that might come in. So that's one of our goals. So our goal really 3 to 5 years from now is to be able to support everyone from the household level. Just imagining where you don't have to worry about where to actually source your power, and you can just basically tell you action points. And besides that, we're slowly helping also the company, or at least the country, I mean, to a point where energy transition is really feasible. So one of the main issues why renewable energy investments in the country are not flowing that much, at least before in the prior years, because of the volatility of the RE. So effectively, an RE RE production is very volatile. It's not 24/7. So imagine renewable energy. For example, solar, it depends on the production, depends on the sunlight. Wind, it depends on wind. So infusing that kind of volatility in the grid is very difficult, especially in terms of the offtake of the consumers actually getting that power. So having a platform such as ours, which can actually combine these different RE capacities for supply and demand, will allow more players to come in from an investment standpoint, from different, basically international companies. In fact, on the side, we're consulting some international players who wants to invest RE capacities in the Philippines. So the future of energy in the Philippines is really good from a supplier standpoint and from the demand standpoint. Yeah.
Got it. I can see now. I can see how now SolX can actually bring in more power suppliers from abroad, because there's a right way now for them to insert.
Correct. Yeah.
Grid, because now the B2B can use them properly because they know when to bring them in, and they use the power when they need it. And they can tell right now. Using the app. Is that correct, Mike?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's a very good summary. Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
Fantastic. Now, having said that, it's been a really great learning for everybody over here. And what you have is sort of like a large lens of seeing opportunity in the power sector, or even from the startup sector in SolX. Other entrepreneurs and tech startup people, or people who are just interested in doing business over here, What are the opportunities that you still see, that you wouldn't pursue? But you see, RJ, by time I do this one or do that one. What are these opportunities that you're seeing that other entrepreneurs can pursue from the tech startup field or the power field?
I wouldn't trust myself in other sectors, but definitely there are a lot of I really know that the power industry, the energy industry, is something that can be innovated. There's so much potential. The EV app is coming, and the renewable portfolio standard for maintaining renewable energy for different suppliers is coming. So there's a lot of untapped potential in the energy market in the Philippines, especially because we're an archipelago, and Before, the Luzon and Visayas grid are the only connected grid, meaning if you have excess supply from Luzon, you can only give it to the Visayas. Right now, the Mindanao will be connected. So effectively, you can transfer energy from the entire Philippine grid. So in terms of opportunities, at least in the power sector, there's a lot. But I would say it's a good time to enter the startup field or to be an entrepreneur. Why? Because prior to when I entered to now, there are a lot of accelerator companies that offers you that safety net from the risk appetite that I was mentioning earlier. So that accelerators are international accelerators from California, the new energy nexus, supporting startups from initial conception, ideation. Idea Space is also a big a supporter for early stage companies, Kubo, and BrainSparks also supporting different ideas. So there's a lot of funds also from the government, the Startup Venture Fund, and also the Department of Science and Technology offering equity-free grants. So it's a good time to apply or to be an entrepreneur because there are a lot of support system that will allow you to hedge on that risk appetite of being able to provide for your family vis-a-vis pursuing your own dreams. Yeah.
And hopefully we get more people like you who are highly motivated and want to help the country. I think that's one of the key things that we really need here right now. How to be inspire more people like you out there? I mean, talk to the entrepreneurs here right now. What do you want to tell them?
If you're on the fence of starting a company versus going corporate first, I would say it's really a fine balance, but I would say it's important to take the leap. At least if you're ready, if you have that emotional bandwidth, you just jump, because what you're gonna learn in a corporate culture is something that you will apply in the startup after a few years. Because when you go corporate, you're gonna be put in a very established setting, systems, processes. And a startup in the first 2 years is very agile. You have to learn a lot. You have to be a jack of all trades. You have to wear a lot of hats. So that's something that you won't learn anywhere. So that corporate mentality of being, before you can start a company, I have to, you know, have experience. I think in some cases it might be too skewed, because starting a company is in itself a different thing. So just jump, learn from the support system. And if the idea doesn't work, maybe go corporate. And then if you have a good idea after the fact, then you can apply both, having that startup level of experience and having that corporate experience. You can combine both at the same time. But before starting a company, the important thing is really know who you're going to partner with, your friends, and know your level of motivation. How motivated are you going to be? And third is, it's very important to have a very honest assessment of yourself. If risk is very difficult for you because of financial issues, accept that. Don't just jump because you think that this is going to work out. So accept that by creating a system of hedging for yourself. Basically, if you're going to start a startup with financial issues, learn how to balance maybe a part-time work while slowly building your startup and getting an angel investment. So it's very important to not just jump, but have a very clear and honest understanding of where you're currently situated at personally and from a family standpoint. Yeah.
Really, really great advice, Rich. And I'm so happy to hear that. It's a very refreshing thing I'm getting from you here right now. And as we start to close out our discussion over here, are there any management hacks or success hacks that you have that you would have wished that you told the younger Serge when he was setting up XR originally?
Yeah, the first one is what I mentioned earlier. It's okay to do business with friends, but no matter who you do business with, create a system that forces accountability and forces trust. The shareholders agreement, it's very important to put that in the very beginning, because it's very hard to exit the founder once you vest a certain level of shares. So trust is important, but having that people with you that knows that there needs to be a system is also equally important. And that's the first. And the second is I also mentioned this briefly, but having that level of awareness of your weakness. Maybe a lot of people have mentioned it, but it's very important to hire your weakness. Learn how to actually know where you really excel at, excel in, and where do you actually struggle with in terms of are you a front-end person in terms of being able to close good, manage relationships, or are you more of an operator? So you have to hire witness, but it's equally important not to just to hire witness, but learn from them so that you can equally apply that to you know, your weakness to be holistic eventually. And maybe third is having a very clear vision of where you want your company to be. Because I started this company with just the vision that I want to try, I want to take a risk, and there are safety nets involved. But I realized slowly that it's very important to build a vision. The vision that we have right now is to be a catalyst to enable people, to empower people. So we do it both internally and externally. So why do I say internally? So all the hires that we have, we focus on people that from the provinces that have not been given the same level of opportunity as the people from Manila, but are actually equally good or even better. But their level of motivation is really high. So providing them that opportunity and that level of salary in Manila is very important for them, because they will not be able to get that unless they migrate from the provinces to the Philippines. So that kind of empowerment mentality internally, and allowing everyone in the company to, before meeting with them, what are your three-year goal? If you want to exit from us, it's okay, but we want to know where you're at. So that's something that we develop eventually, not having that mentality that everyone can be indispensable, dispensable actually, as bad as it sounds. Everyone can be replaced. As bad as it sounds, it's the way that it should be, because everyone has to grow, whether it's in your company or outside your company. But that's very important, to have that level of empowerment mentality internally. And externally, how we want to build that empowerment culture is really to provide affordable and accessible electricity eventually to all Filipinos. The main reason why I'm saying that is because we hired wrong before. We hired based on credentials and based on skills instead of actual grit and potential. So that's something that we have to balance. And yeah, I think at least for now, those are the things that I can think of. Yeah.
Really, really great lessons. I appreciate these coming from you. And what I appreciate from this conversation is that there are certain things that you got to learn, because like you said, no, if you had a corporate mentality, you wouldn't actually be thinking this way, that eventually your people might leave you. But or that they're all dispensable. But I like how you said that at the very start, you already recognize that, and especially for a startup type of operation, that that's how it might work out.
Correct, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but more importantly for me, I like the idea that, you know, there's a, aside from what you're doing, there's a meaningfulness and relevance to what you're doing for SolX Technologies. It's not just for the businesses, but eventually, how does that redound to the regular everyday Filipino consumer? Mm-hmm. And that, I think that, that's really what gives you your North Star in doing SolX Technologies.
Exactly, North Star. Yeah, that's a great word. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you so much for this opportunity to interview you. I wish you good luck in the upcoming World Cup finals. Where's it going to be? Is it this year or next year?
It's either this year or next year, because supposedly it's next year, because the last year's winner is supposed to compete for this year. But they're inviting us as well for this year. So I don't know. We'll see how it pans out. So it's either this year or the next year. But yeah, thank you very much. Hopefully we can represent the country really well. Yeah.
Good luck. We are going to be rooting for you and praying for you again. Thank you so much, Sergius, from SolX Technologies. Good luck to you. Thanks so much for guesting here on the RJ Ledesma Podcast. Guys, we will see you, and you will hear from us again in the next podcast. Thanks so much, guys. Have a great night. Serge, hang around.